Amen, brothers and sisters. Good morning. Welcome to worship. We're coming here and we are in now the season of Lent, this time when we remember this final stretch, this final time that we are in as we are going into Easter, as Jesus is making his journey to the cross for us. And as he goes, there are people who cry out to him, some we'll hear about today, and I wanted to read this reminder for us that when we call out, God answers. It's from the end of Psalm 91, and I want us to listen. This first part is the psalmist who's crying out to God, and the last part where it says, I, that is God answering. So hear this. Because he loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him, for he acknowledges my name. He will call on me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him with long life. I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. You know, we think about this, that this person has been crying out to God, and God is faithful and just. He answers when the psalmist cries out. And the true is same for us. Amen? Amen. We come into worship and God greets us with these words. To those who have been called and who are kept by God the Father, grace, mercy, and peace be yours, both now and forevermore. Amen. I invite you to be seated. So I want to direct your attention to our bulletin, because we got a lot going on here. First of all, we had our game night last night. We had a really great time. Next month, we're planning on doing that next month as well. So if you're looking for a time to just come and play, and kids are invited as well, just to come hang out and enjoy each other's company and play some games while we're doing it, please come. I want to also let you see this. We're going to, you'll notice there's something extra in your bulletin, an extra special goodie. Pull out that paper. And don't throw it away. Put the rest of your bulletin. I want you to look at this. This was something that was shared with us, and we as a worship committee, we were talking about some ways that we can experience Lent, and especially last week as we had our foot washing and as we remembered service, and guess what? We got instructions for us. Every week there is an invitation for a way to show love. An invitation to a different practice of love for here in our church. And so I want you, if you can, put this on your fridge. You know, put it somewhere where you're not going to lose it, where it's going to be in front of you. And each week you'll see there's a different invitation. This week, write a note or email or a letter to a day to a friend. Tell someone how much you appreciate him or her. Show this love of Christ. That's this week. Keep that on hand. Don't lose it. We've got lots of stuff here. This coming week, March 9, Wednesday, is the annual day of prayer. And I'm going to be here at church, 8:30 a.m. I didn't do any planning for this. I'm just going to be here, and I thought I'd love to invite anyone and everyone who's willing or interested in coming and praying over whatever it might be, whether it's our nation or the world or in our own lives. I'd just like to invite you into that space and that time. So that'll be Wednesday morning, 8:30 a.m. Maybe I'll have the coffee going to entice you, but I'll be here, and I welcome you to come and join me. So, look, there's so much to see here, which is really encouraging, isn't it? That we have so much good stuff going on in our congregation, in our church. So make sure you take a look at this. Make sure you read through it and just be encouraged and encouraged by all that God is doing here in our church. So with that, we also would like to welcome, we have some visitors this morning. Make sure if after church and our time of coffee and cookies to make sure we greet anyone you don't know. Or maybe there's somebody who has been around here and you really don't know them, but now's the time to go up and say hi if you haven't met them yet. So if you're visiting with us, we have a practice. We have a practice as we go into our time of worship before we go into a time of prayer to kind of quietly calm our hearts. a time to quietly settle down for a few moments just to come into God's presence and to be reminded of why we are here to worship, who we are here to serve and who we are here to experience, and that's God. So let's come quiet our hearts before we lift up our hearts in prayer. Let's go to God in prayer. Father God, you are the creator. You're the one who holds all things. You are the one from whom all blessings flow. You are the one who holds us and watches us so that not a hair can fall from our head without you knowing it. You are the God who creates and breathes life. You are the God who holds all life in your hands. You are the God who can make blind men see, lame men walk. You are the one who softens hard hearts. Lord, as we go through these acknowledgments of who you are, just makes us stop. Makes me stop. It makes me stop from the chaos of this world and realize just how powerful you are and how, if we have a powerful God like yourself, we really have no need to be afraid. Lord, I thank you as a wonderful God as you are that you provide us so richly with so many things. I thank you for opportunities to love each other here in this church and in our community. Thank you for the opportunity as we go into this Lenten season to show your love, even in our food truck this last week, that we could show our neighborhood that we love them. We care for them, that we want to support them. I thank you, Lord, for opportunities to show love, to come together as a church, to spend time in fellowship like we did last night, to spend time laughing and talking, using our minds, and Lord, part of how you have made us like you is you have given us minds to think. Thank you, Lord, that we could come together last night and just be together. In this way. Lord, I thank you for generosity in this church. There's so much of it. There's giving of hearts, giving and helping for those in need. There's support given for those who are hurting. Lord, thank you for these ways that people show love in our congregation and more. Thank you for cards which are written to those who are lonely. Thank you, Lord, for visits for people who are hurting. Lord, we acknowledge all of these good things that you give us. Within our own hearts and our own lives, there are many things for which we're thankful. Maybe we're just thankful for the opportunity to come this morning. Lord, as we live in a world that's broken, there are many things that we need. There are many things that we don't understand. There are many things that hurt us. There are many things that make us anxious. Even as we know all things are in your hands, we acknowledge that we are imperfect and we sometimes trust in you imperfectly. Sometimes, Lord, our faith is small. Sometimes, Lord, we allow our fears to overtake us. Strengthen us, Holy Spirit. Make us strong. Make our faith move mountains. Lord, as we remember this again, reaffirming that you are a powerful and mighty God, I pray, Lord, for our world and for our nation and for our community. Lord, I pray for our community, for those here in our neighborhood, for those who you place in our paths, for those who we can help. Lord, where there is hurting, may we address it. May we, as your church, bring the wholeness, the shalom, the peace that you offer. Lord, for our nation, where there is much division, I again pray just that you will bring healing, that you would find, that you would work in people's hearts to seek after you with all of their heart. I pray, Lord, that you would work in our hearts to show love and to show compassion and to lead the way in what it is to speak for your truth, to put aside our truth, to put aside our opinions in order to glorify and honor you first and foremost. May we lead the way in this. Lord, for our world right now, we think about the situation in Ukraine and the assault on the people there. Lord, I pray for them. I pray for peace. You are the Prince of Peace, Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray that violence would come to an end. We look towards that day when there will be no more violence, when swords will be beaten into plowshares used to farm the fields and bring food that gives life. Until that day, Lord, we pray against tyranny. We pray for freedom in your name. Again, Lord, it is not us who changes hearts, that's you. So I pray for those who are in power. I pray, Lord, that you would be even with President Putin, that you would be with him, that he would know who you are. You would be with our leaders. May they know who you are. May you, Lord, just work your kingdom. May your kingdom come and your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. Holy Spirit, we believe you can change hearts and you start with us, but may that spread. May that spread out into this world so that your kingdom might be seen fully. Lord, we come to you not as perfect people, but imperfect people. We don't have the answers. We don't have it all together. But we come trusting in you. We come not always being able to see, not always being able to walk. But we still come to you. Lord, I thank you for the opportunity that we have this morning to give to you and back to your kingdom. That we have the opportunity to give of ourselves of the blessings that you've given us. I pray that you, Lord, would receive these gifts that we give in our offerings. That you would take them and bless them and multiply them and use them to strengthen and build your kingdom, which is based on the truth of Jesus Christ. As we're in this Lenten season, as we worship, Lord, may we be reminded of the journey we are on. I pray this all in Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen. I invite our deacons to come forward to receive our offering. We'll have it for our general fund and then also for our reserve fund. And if you're visiting with us, we have what's called the noisy offering. And I like to say you'll know it when you hear it. It's an invitation to come forward if you have spare change. That offering will go towards Mel Trotter Bible Distribution Ministry. And then afterwards, we'll have a children's message. We invite the children to stay up here with after the offering. So.
Hi, girls and boys. We're going to read a story. But first, I got to ask you guys a question. Did you ever ask for something very expensive? No? Okay. How about a big birthday gift or party? Did you ever ask for that? No? Okay. Did you ever ask your parents for something that, and they had to say no? Yeah. Do you think that they love you anyways? Just because they said no. Did you know that faith in Jesus is a gift that's given by the Holy Spirit? Good. I'm glad you know that. All right. We got one more question, but we're going to read this first. This is from Luke. The parable of the blind man receives his sight. As Jesus approached Jericho, a blind man was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard the crowd going by, he asked what was happening. They told him, "Jesus of Nazareth is passing by." He called out, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." Those who led the way rebuked him. That means they said, "Be quiet." So, anyways, they told him to be quiet. But he still said, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stopped and ordered the man to be brought to him. When he came near, Jesus asked him, "What do you want me to do for you?" "Lord, I want to see," he replied. Jesus said to him, "Receive your sight. Your faith has healed you." Immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus, praising God. When the people saw it, they also praised God. So, that blind man got a sight back. But what did Jesus say? What did Jesus say when he said, "Thank you for my sight"? He said, "Your faith has healed you." So if we have faith in Jesus, Jesus can do amazing things in our lives, right? Let's pray and thank God for faith. Heavenly Father, we thank you for sending your Holy Spirit into this world so that we can have faith and believe that you can do amazing things for us. We thank you, Lord, for allowing us to come together and worship and to hear more about your word and about the Holy Spirit. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen.
Many of you know we've been going through a sermon series on practices for a new year. We're actually going to take a break from that, as now we are in the season of Lent, and we're entering into a new sermon series during this time of Lent leading up to Easter, and it's going to be about those who Jesus has encountered, those who Jesus encounters in his final journey from going up, leading up to Easter, those who Jesus encounters and how they experience Jesus. What does Jesus do in his final journey, in his final trip, as he goes to Jerusalem to be crucified and when he will eventually rise again from the dead? And right now, like I said, we're in the season of Lent. You know, we have seasons of the year. We know those all. We've got winter and spring and summer and fall. But right now we have also a church calendar. We have church seasons, and we are in the season of Lent. These seasons are meant to remind us of our walk with God through the year and where we are and where he is with us and where we are going. And so the season of Lent, it's this time leading up to Easter. So this morning we're going to read about actually two people who encounter Jesus, or who Jesus encounters, We're going to start in Luke 18, verse 35, and Dan just read this for us. I'm going to read it again, and then we're going to go through chapter Luke 19, verse 10. So hear this word from the book of Luke. As Jesus approached Jericho, a blind man was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard the crowd going by, he asked what was happening. They told him, "Jesus of Nazareth is passing by." He called out, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." Those who led the way rebuked him and told him to be quiet. But he shouted all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stopped and ordered the man to be brought to him. When he came near, Jesus asked him, "What do you want me to do for you?" "Lord, I want to see," he replied. Jesus said to him, "Receive your sight. Your faith has healed you." Immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus, praising God. When all the people saw it, they also praised God. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see Jesus, who Jesus was, but because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today." So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, "He has gone to be the guest of a sinner." But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor, and if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount." Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. Thank you for these words, Lord, and as we examine them together, be with us. Spirit, open our hearts that we may hear your voice. Remind us, Lord, of who you are once again. Thank you for this. Thank you for this time together. I pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. So, I don't know if you've ever had this, but when you're on a trip, and you've been on a long journey, and you get to a point on that trip and you realize you're almost home. For me, I always knew that when I was traveling from Chicago, where my parents lived, back here where I lived for college, there was one point on 196 right by Holland, and you're heading north, and all of a sudden it starts to curve. It starts to head east. And that's the point I knew. I was almost home. I knew I was almost there. I knew that my journey was almost done. I like to think that's actually where Jesus is right now in this trip that he's on. Jesus is on his way. He's been making a journey. People in the ancient world, when they would go to Jerusalem, he's on his way there for the celebration of Passover. And if you look here, this is the Jordan River. People would travel down that. You can still see there's still roads that go that way. And he's traveling there, and here's Jerusalem. And as he's traveling down, the final stretch as he's about to come down and go into Jerusalem is the city of Jericho, which you can see right there. That's Jericho. That's the final stop on the journey. That's the bend in the road as Jesus is making his final journey. As he's making his final journey to Jerusalem. It's amazing to me that as Jesus is going on this final trip and this final journey, it's amazing who he encounters. If I were him, if I were Jesus, and I knew what was coming, that I was on my way to Jerusalem in order to he knows he's going to go and be crucified. I don't know about you. I don't know if I'd really want to stop. I don't know if I'd really want to stop and talk to anybody. My mind might be preoccupied. And yet, as we see here in this, what we've just read, he doesn't just stop once, he stops twice for two different people. If you have your Bible with you, if you go back to the beginning of our first text, Luke chapter 18, verse 35, look at this. As Jesus approaches Jericho, as he's driving north on 196, approaching Holland, he's coming into Jericho. He's rounding this bend, coming into the final stretch of his journey. That's where he encounters this blind man. That's where he encounters this guy who's sitting and asking and begging. There's a lot of similarities here between these two men that we read about. There's one man who is blind, and then there's Zacchaeus. We've maybe heard those stories separately, but I think it's good for us to think, actually, they go together. There's a lot of similarities between them, and the first is here that they're both in Jericho. They're both in Jericho. They're both in this city at this turning point on the journey. This is where Jesus encounters them. They're both in the city of Jericho, this final stretch, this big city before their final stretch on the way to Jerusalem. Interestingly enough, they are both outcasts as well, you might say. I think they're both outcasts. We see the blind man in chapter 18. He's begging. And it says he hears the crowd going by and he asks what's happening and they tell him Jesus is coming by. And all of a sudden he calls out, he says, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. And what do they tell him to do? We could quite literally translate that, shut up. Be quiet. We don't want to hear you. You are being a nuisance. More than that, there are some scholars who think that that the crowd is also upset because he's using a particular phrase, Son of David. Son of David is a claim to kingship in the city of Jerusalem. And as the Roman guards, the Romans who are occupying this territory and are really politically in charge, and they're standing right there, we might imagine. And he's calling out this political title, Son of David. Be quiet, you're going to get us in trouble. You're going to get us in trouble. He's an outcast. People don't seem to like him very much. And then there's Zacchaeus, the chief tax collector. And he's wealthy. He too is an outcast, I think. I want to make a distinction here because I think sometimes tax collectors in our day might get a bad rap because of Zacchaeus. We hear about Zacchaeus, we always have. But I want to make a distinction. It's very different what Zacchaeus is doing and what he has done in his life and in his career is very different than what we might imagine as somebody who works for the IRS or a tax agency. It's a very different thing. What would happen is the Roman government would come in, the Roman who is the supreme power in the ancient world, and they'd settle a place and they'd say, hey, you, would you be interested in making some extra money and being on our good side? You know, if you want to work for us and collect taxes, we'll let you, actually, you can take a cut off the top and you can decide what that margin is going to be. You can collect the taxes for us and you can decide how much money you want to take off the top for yourself. So these are people who are, you might say, traitors. They're friends and family of the Jewish people who have decided they're going to work for the occupying forces. They're traitors. They're getting ahead. They're cheating their family and friends. They're getting wealthy. It tells us Zacchaeus is not just wealthy. He says he's a chief tax collector. He's the head honcho. He's the one who's got it all. He's maybe overseeing other tax collectors. We get the picture. He's an outcast. Nobody likes him. I think, interestingly enough, I think in a way they are both blind. Quite literally, there's the one man who's blind. We see that. He's lived his life not being able to see. And here comes Jesus, and he just wants to see, right? He's blind physically. But I think Zacchaeus himself is also blind. He's spiritually blind. He can't see past the end of his nose what is right. He's sold out. He can't see that what he's doing is wrong. He is somebody who people don't really want to associate with. He's an outcast in Jericho. He can't see what's right or wrong. I think they're both blind. There's perhaps more similarities we might draw between them, but I think the picture we get here is that these are both people who are easily ignored. They're easily hated. They're perhaps easily left out of the group. They're easily forgotten. I was talking with a pastor friend of mine this week, and he told me a story about somebody who he knew who was in the church, not his church, but a church, and this guy committed a terrible crime, a crime which most of us would look at and say, he did what? As I heard this story, I felt the repulsion growing up within my own heart of thinking, how could somebody do that? And this man went to prison for a long time. As he went, the pastor thought he was going to go and visit this guy. And when he got there, the man looked at him and said, "Why have you come? Don't you know that all of my friends and family have abandoned me? Nobody wants to talk to me anymore. Nobody wants to visit me anymore. My family has abandoned me because of what I've done. I've lost my friends. Nobody visits me. Why are you here?" It doesn't take much for us to think about people like that, perhaps in our world. People who either are an inconvenience, perhaps, in our hearts. Maybe they're people we don't really like. Maybe they're just people who walk on the other side of the political aisle than we do. Or maybe they're people who have done terrible things. It's easy to think of people like that. Both of these men are in that category for many people of their day. People don't want to be bothered by them. People don't like them. Who would stop for them? Well, Jesus does. Jesus, on the way to the cross, on the way in his final journey, as he approaches Jerusalem, where he will be taunted and mocked and crucified, as he's got all that on his mind, as he rounds the bend at Holland, going up 196 towards Grand Rapids, wanting to be done with his journey, perhaps, he stops. And these are the two people he stops to talk with. I have to imagine there's a lot of people he could have stopped and talked with. But it's these two guys. The blind man begging and sitting on the side of the road who nobody else wants to talk with, and Zacchaeus, a traitor tax collector who's betrayed everybody and nobody likes him. These are the two people who Jesus decides to stop and talk with. You know, as they're going, as Jesus is going, and as Jesus encounters them, it's interesting to stop and look at what do they actually want. The first man, the blind man, as Jesus is coming close to Jericho, what does he want? He calls out, we might miss this, but it's important for us to see his desperation. If we look at verse 38 of chapter 18, he called out, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." And then they tell him, "Be quiet." And then all of a sudden, it uses a different word the next time it says it. He says, but then he shouted all the more. It's not just shouted. It's like an animalistic cry. He's screaming it out with all of his passion, unreserved. All he wants, he'll do anything. He's screaming this at the top of his lungs. "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." He's not just asking, he's screaming it because he has no other option. Jesus stops and asks him, "What do you want me to do?" "Lord, I want to see." He wants to be healed. And Zacchaeus, I don't know if Zacchaeus even knows what he wants. But he knows he wants to get a look at this person coming into their town. Zacchaeus wants to get a quick glimpse of what's going on. Zacchaeus wants a quick glimpse of this guy named Jesus. And it's amazing to me, even though he doesn't know what he needs and what he wants, Jesus knows. And he's looking out in the crowd and he sees Zacchaeus and, "Come here, Zacchaeus, I know what you need. You need me to come to your house. You need to invite me into your life. You might not know what you want, but I know what you need," Jesus says. And I think Jesus gives both of these men healing. As Jesus stops, it's amazing. They're both healed. And it is all because Jesus stops. My guess is this week we might encounter people who we might be tempted to pass by. Maybe there are people in our life. Maybe there are people we know. Maybe it's the guy on the street corner. It's amazing because Jesus stops, and I think he invites us to do so as well. Or maybe we're the person. If it were the person who's sitting by the street corner of our life asking for help and begging, maybe we're like Zacchaeus and we don't know why anyone would want to stop and talk with us. I don't know where you are. But we might ask that question, "Would Jesus want to stop and talk with me?" And I can assure you the answer is yes. Jesus wants to stop and be with each and every one of you. He wants to give you what you need. We're going on this journey together into the season of Lent, into this season where we're remembering Jesus' journey and time going into his crucifixion. And I want to start it by reminding each and every one of you that you are someone who Jesus wants to stop for. He doesn't want to leave you by the side of the road. The thing is, though, when he stops, there's much rejoicing. It doesn't just stop that he stops and then things keep going like they were before. Look at what happens with everybody who stops here, or where Jesus stops and talks with them. Immediately, chapter 18, verse 43, immediately he, the blind man, received his sight and followed Jesus, praising God. And when all the people saw it, they also praised God. Look at this rejoicing. It doesn't mean just stopping and staying where you are. It means following Jesus. It means that's what we do. We follow Jesus with our whole heart. We don't continue in our patterns of how we were before. We follow Jesus. He is the Lord of our life. Look at Zacchaeus. Jesus comes and meets him here. And what does Zacchaeus do? He gives back all that he's cheated people out of. So I understand that it was acceptable if somebody had committed a wrong or something like that to give like 20% back. 20% back to those who have been wronged. Look what Zacchaeus does. I'll pay them back four times the amount. He's giving back in abundance. This is his response to what Jesus has done. He's giving back in abundance. When Jesus meets us on the road and he comes to our house, how do we respond? What does that look like as we go into this season of Lent, as we follow Jesus to Jerusalem? Thankfully, we have this sheet here to help us with maybe how we can do that. If you're wondering how to do that, if you're wondering how maybe Jesus is calling you to serve and how to show love, maybe keep this again on your refrigerator. Maybe this will help guide you, or maybe there's something else that you just feel the Spirit leading you to do. Whatever it might be, listen. Don't ignore the voice of the Spirit as he guides you and leads you, as he's healed you. The responses aren't necessarily the same, just as they aren't for the blind man and for Zacchaeus. Maybe it's different for you, but listen to that voice. As we go into this week, I want us to consider these questions as we look at this text and as we consider it, as we go in, and if you want to know more, join us this afternoon at 4 o'clock. We'll talk more about it. But what are some of the similarities between the two men in these stories? And how does Jesus meet their needs? What needs do they have? The question, how might Jesus stop in on your life? What does that look like? How would you feel if he did? How might you feel if Jesus stopped and said, I'm coming to your house right now? How might he meet your needs? What needs do you have that he wants to meet? And this week, how might you act just like Jesus in our busy lives and stop on our journeys? Who is it in your life who needs mercy? We consider all of these things as we follow Jesus, as we go into the season of Lent, as we follow him to Jerusalem, as we'll see all the other people he encounters. I'm sure Jesus has things to teach us as we go on this journey with him. My prayer for us is that as we follow, he'll speak to us and that we'll see where he is leading us and what he would have for us, and remind us again that he will stop for each and every one of us. Let's pray. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, I thank you for this text that reminds us once again that you want to stop for each and every one of us. There's no one who you cannot stop for. There's no one who you will ignore. There's no one who is crying out who you won't answer. May we hear your voice and receive your invitation. May we follow you with our whole heart, with all of our self, with all of our being. Lord, your love was not contingent on if we have done the right thing or the wrong thing. Zacchaeus certainly had done wrong, and yet you stop for him. Help us to remember this, Lord. This is the kind of God you are. I pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite us to rise in body or in spirit to sing a song of response. Here I am, Lord. Friends, as we go on this Lenten journey together, going off to serve our God, remembering that He's already stopped for us along the road as we were curious and looking in, we go with His blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine upon you and to be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up His face toward you and give you His peace. Amen.